to the video about unit testing and code coverage measurement with TESI. My name is Frank from the company Hitex in Germany. I'm Principal Engineer Software Quality at Hitex, and I would like to start the video by giving you an overview of what I plan to do in the next minutes. First, we need to look into some theory, first about unit testing of C or C++ programs in general, and second I will explain in theory what TESI does for unit testing. This is important because a lot of things happen under the hood when you use TESI, so it's important to understand what happens under the hood. In the second point here, I would like to do a practical demonstration of TESI and showing you how unit testing and code coverage measurement works and how a test case looks like and so on. And concluding, I would like to give you a very quick overview of the features of TESI, which I were not able to cover in the practical demonstration. So let's get starting. About unit testing of C and C++ programs, and the main question here is what is a unit? That's the first question that came to mind if we talk about unit testing. And in my opinion, this depends on the programming language that you are using. If C is a programming language, the test object of unit testing or module testing are the functions in the sense of C. And I have two terms here, units and module, depending on the safety critical standards that you are working towards. You might call this units or you might call this modules. For me, it is the same. If the programming language is C++, the situation is similar, but now the methods of the classes are the test objects for unit testing or module testing. Again, you can use either name. It does not. I do not insist on a certain name. Clarified this, we can think of a software application as looking like this. The red rectangles represent the units or the modules or the function or the methods, and the red arrows represent the calling hierarchy. And to answer the question, what does unit testing mean for such a unit? I would like to look at a unit which has a calling function above and calls itself another unit. So the question is, what does unit testing mean here for this unit in the middle of the blue frame? And this is depicted here. Unit testing means testing in isolation from the rest of the application. Each unit is tested separately and rigorously. And rigorously means that I do not use only the normal test data, but I try also to use illegal values, extreme values, unexpected values, and so on, to see how the unit behaves on such inputs. Isolation of the unit under test to the rest application appears at two points. We see here isolation to the calling function and isolation to called function. In case our test object calls other units or functions during pure unit testing, they are replaced by so-called stub functions. And this is the isolation to the called function. So isolation to the calling function has an advantage, then you can use arbitrary test cases, arbitrary test data during unit testing. Let me explain this here in this little example. There's a function f1 which calls a function f2, but only if the pointer that is passed from f1 to f2 is not a null pointer. And the first thing F2 does is it checks if the passed parameter is a null pointer, and in case it is, F2 returns a certain error number to the calling function. So, and if you consider this situation here during system testing or during integration testing, it's rather easy to understand that you have a hard time to check if F2 checks correctly for a null pointer as parameter and if F2 returns the correct error number in case it has detected a null pointer. And but during unit testing of F2, it is rather simple and easy to pass a null pointer as an input to F2 and see if it is detected correctly and if the correct error number is returned, because you can easily pass, technically easily pass any value to as a pointer to F2 during unit testing. That's the advantage of the isolation to the calling function. But there is also isolation to the called function. So in case our unit calls other units, they are replaced by stub functions. And this means that everything outside this blue line is under our control during testing. This means the isolation of the test object also allows for determinism. That means a unit test, if it returns a certain result today, it should return the same result in a fortnight, because we have everything under control and nothing can change without we know about it. This means unit tests are reproducible, and this is a prerequisite for regression testing. And regression testing, is a repetition of already passed test cases to see if maybe a bug fix or something like that did not cause any trouble. Okay, the blue line here is often called the interface. I call it the interface of the function, and we have now a closer look on this interface. The interface consists of two parts. An upper part here, which says input values belong to the interface. Input values are variables that are read by the by the test object, but not written, and output variables are variables that are written by the test object but not read. Of course, the return value, if our test object has a return value, the return value belongs to the output variables, and of course, a variable can be input and output at the same time. Think of a global variable which is incremented by our test object, so it is first read by the test object, so it's input, and then it is written increment, then it is incremented by the test object, and then it is written back, so it's output. So it can be input and output. A variable can be input and output. That's about the upper part of this interface. You think you were expecting something like this, but be aware that the interface also consists of this lower part. In case our test object calls other functions, the values of the parameters which are passed from the test object to the stub function are output variables, and in case our called function has a return value, it is belong to the input variables, so the input variables, because we hope that if our called function has a return value, that the test object considers this return value and behaves accordingly, so it's clear that it's input. Okay, this was a harder part of the theory. This picture here displays the situation after the process step of unit testing. All units are considered tested. But the errors are still red, which means we do not know at this point in time if the units interact correctly. This is left to a later process step, which is called integration testing and which is not subject of the video at hand. Okay, so let's move forward to the next topic. How does unit testing with TESI works? We already know that our test objects are the function or the methods of a source file. So we specify a source file to TESI, and then TESI analyzes this source file and lists all the possible test objects in it, either the C function or the methods. And what is more important is TESI determines the interface of each test object. We have already learned about the test about the interface in details. This here is a much more simplified version of the interface, only the upper part with the input and output variables. And the table below here, this picture specifies a very simple interface. The first two lines, which are shaded in gray, represent a very simplified interface. This interface consists of a variable A, which is input, and a variable B, which is input and output, a variable C, which is only output, and this interface also includes a return value, which is of course output. Usually we have also the data types and then of an interface. So the first two lines represent a very simple interface, and the interface determines the structure of a test case, because the interface tells us for which variables we need to specify values prior to the test and for which variables we need to specify expected values. And therefore the third line here, the line shaded in yellow, gives a simple example test case. This case says prior to the test the variable A should have the value 5, and prior to the test the variable B should have the value 4, and we have expect that B has a value 8 after the test. And because C is an output only variable, we only have a value, an expected value, which is 17, and we expect that our test object returns a value 42 after the test. So this is the way how the interface specifies the structure of a test case. The task of test case specification, in my opinion, is a human task, which means a human needs to think and contemplate and decide about how many test cases we need and which values we should use in these test cases. In my opinion, there is no automatic test case generation which makes really sense. But after the test cases are specified, everything else of unit testing is automated by TESI. The first step is that TESI creates what we call a test application. You see here the test application. The heart of the test application consists of the test object, which is here the green area, and this is the unchanged source code, usually unchanged source code of the test object. The blue parts are generated by TESI, and you see the blue parts contain main, so it's a standalone application. And if you have directed TESI to create stub functions or something like that, they are created automatically by TESI. If you intend to run the test application on a certain microcontroller, you are able to provide the correct startup code for your microcontroller, which is then linked to the test application by TESI and so on. The test data is not included in the test application. This means the size of the test application does not depend on the number of test cases. Okay, so test application is created in source code. So the next step is that TESI compiles the test application into something executable, and there are basically two possibilities which are depicted here. On the left hand side you see the native GNU compiler. You can use a native GNU compiler, and then the test application is compiled into a Windows executable, and you can execute all the tests on Windows without having a hardware. It is might be better to do as on the right hand side, to use a cross compiler for an embedded microcontroller. Usually the cross compiler that you use in your embedded project with the same version number, with the same optimization level, and so on. This means TESI compiles a test application in a binary for a certain microcontroller, but then you need an execution environment which allows TESI to execute this binary, and usually TESI uses the software debugger of your embedded project, of your development environment, as execution environment. And this software debugger can act as an instruction set simulator here on the left hand side, which means you can execute the tests without actual target hardware, or this debugger can act as an interface to an in-circuit emulator, or this software debugger can interact as an interface to a hardware debug device, a JTAG debugger or something like that, which is then connected to the actual target hardware. What is different between these two choices? In my opinion, it's the relevance of the test. Relevance of the test means how sure can you be that a result from unit testing will also be the same in system testing or in your final product release. And if you use a GNU compiler, this test relevance can be rather low because the compiler might be quite different to the embedded cross compiler. The GNU compiler is a 32-bit micro compiler, and maybe your cross compiler is a 16-bit compiler for a 16-bit microcontroller. So there's a difference in the integer size. There could be a difference in the endianness. There could be an difference in the packing of structures, and so on and so on. This arrow here has a gap. This means, in my opinion, the difference between the test application as a Windows application and the test application as a binary for a microcontroller is much more bigger than the difference between the test application which is executed in a simulated environment and on the actual target hardware. Let's have a look on two of these possibilities. So microcontroller binary executed in a simulated environment and on the actual target hardware. You see here these two possibilities side by side. First of all, you notice that TESI only communicates with a software debugger, and TESI does not really know if the tests are executed on the host only with the instruction set simulator and or on the actual target hardware as depicted on the right hand side on this of this picture. As you see on the left hand side, an instruction set simulator is used and no hardware is involved. And the right hand side, you see that the software debugger of your development environment acts as an interface to a hardware debug system, and this is connected to the actual target hardware with the actual microcontroller. To make this more concrete, I have here replaced the abstract names by concrete names. On the left hand side, you see the simulation is a T-SIM from Infineon for the Aurix microcontroller, and the software debugger which we use here is a universal debug engine from the company PLS. And in both cases, on the left hand side, you see it's connected or acting as an instruction set simulator. On the right hand side, you see this UDE can also be connected to an in-circuit emulator on hardware debug device, and then the tests are executed on the actual target hardware on the actual microcontroller. Okay, we have now the steps. TESI creates a test application, TESI compiles a test application, TESI loads the test application in an execution environment, and then the tests are executed in four steps. Step one means the test input data is transferred from the PC to the test execution environment, which means it can be loaded in the RAM of the target hardware. In step two, the actual test is executed. In step three, the output values, the test result is transferred back from the test execution environment, for instance, the RAM of the target hardware, back to the PC. And in step four, TESI compares the actual result with the expected result. And if it is equal, the test has passed. And if not, the test has failed. And in case a test has failed, you can use quite a nice feature of TESI, which allows you to execute a single test case with a breakpoint. And this means that the test execution will stop in the software debugger, and then you are able to debug a failed test case. You can line step through the code, and you see why a test case did not deliver the expected result. We will see this now in the presentation, because we come now to the point of the live demonstration of TESI, and therefore I switch to TESI. This here is Tessie, and those of you which are familiar with Eclipse will recognize it looks like Eclipse, and this is true because Tessie is based on the Eclipse Edge client platform. This means you have these perspectives which have the views which are considered to be important for a certain task. We are now in the overview perspective, and we have here on the left hand side the test project view, which shows already some test cases, or the test items view and the console view and so on. There are other perspectives, for instance the requirement management perspective, where you can define requirements and link them to test cases, or the classification tree editor perspective, which allows you to apply the classification tree method, a graphical method for test case specification, to specify your test cases. Or this perspective here is for integration testing. We have a textual representation of test cases in the script editor perspective, and we will see the other perspectives during the practical demonstration. Okay, as I said, here on the left hand side we have already some test cases. Test cases are organized here in a tree-like structure, and the root of this tree is called test collection, and I create now a new test collection, and I can give it a name. I can give it a name, video, and I said tree-like structure, which means yeah, I can have an arbitrary folder structure here. This folder structure roughly corresponds to the source code directory layout of your application, and the leaves of this tree are called modules, and they are called modules because they usually correspond to the C source modules of your application. This means these Tessie modules here are connected with C source modules or C++ modules. This is done here. I can browse for a certain C source modules that I want to use. I have here one which is called isValueRange.c, and I select it, and I would like to give you a look inside this C source file. I use a built-in editor in Tessie, and you see here that my C source file only contains one test object, this or one function which is called isValueRange. This means we have only one test object in this C source file, and this test object solves a very simple problem that you want to find out if a value is inside a range. The range is given by a start value and a length, and yeah, you see here the range is a structure with two components, start value and length, and we have an enumeration type as result. And as an example, there are some values. If the start value is 5 and the length is 2, then 4 is not inside the range, it's before the range. 5 is the start value itself, it's inside the range. 6 is inside the range. 7 shall not be inside the range, but due to a programming defect in the software of our test object, yes, is 7 is considered to be inside the range, which is wrong and due to a programming defect. Okay, yeah, let's go back to the overview perspective, and let's have Tessie analyze this C source module. This means Tessie determines the test object, the possible test objects that are inside. In our case, it's only one test object, and Tessie also determines the interface of this test object. We have seen we have only one test object here is value in range, and to see the interface of this test object, we switch to the interface editor perspective. And because our test object is quite simple, our C source file is quite simple. We have no external functions involved. There are no other functions in the C source file. There are no external variables involved. There are no global variables present. What we have are two parameters. The first one is the structure with the two components, start value and length, and Tessie has determined that they have the passing direction in. This means TESI has determined these variables are only read by the test object and not written. And this means for us that if we create a test case, we need to provide values prior to the test for these variables. And the same as for the structure and the components of the structure is true for the second parameter, which is the variable v1. TESI has also determined that it is only input and it is not written by the test object. And v1 is the value of which we want to know if it's inside the range or not. And I think it's clear if you want to know if a value is inside the range, you need to provide the values for the range and the value prior to the test. In our example here, the passing direction out is only for the return value of the test object, and as I said, if a test object has a return value, the passing direction is always out. We see here other things, for instance, the values for the enums and so on, but this is not important. We go now to the test data editor perspective to specify some test cases, and I can create a new test case here in the test items view. In the context menu of the test items view, I can say create new test case, and if I do so, I will get a column here on the right hand side in the test data view, and in this column I'm able to specify values for a test case. So fields shaded in yellow give me the fields where I have to insert data, and I want to use the value I just mentioned during the explanation. I want to use 5 as a start value, 2 as a length, and I want to know if the value 6 is inside the range or not. And because TESI knows the return value is an enumeration type and can only have the values yes and no, I need only to select the correct expected result. And for this input data, yes is the correct expected result of our test case, and I save this test case, and then I can use the context menu here to make a copy of this test case and paste it, and this gives me an identical column here for a second test case. The same test data does not make much sense, so I change now as a 6 to a 7. And from the specification, we know for this input data, no is the correct expected result, but I said due to a programming defect in our test object, the second test case will fail. And to execute the test cases, I just click on this button here, execute test, and now everything what I have explained happens. TESI creates a test application. TESI creates the test application with at the moment with a GCC compiler, but we can change this to a cross compiler, and you will see that we have the same results and it looks quite the same whether if you use a cross compiler or not. And we have now a failed test case and a passed test case as expected. And to change the cross compiler, to a cross compiler, I go back to the general view, and you see here that I have here selected GCC, and this is the only possibility you have if you start, for instance, evaluating TESI. But I have done some setups, and I'm able to select another execution environment, and I select here the high-tech GCC compiler for Aurix or Tricore, and I use the UDE debugger from PLS as execution environment. And don't be confused. The evaluation version is able to use a cross compiler, but you need to set up it properly for TESI, because TESI now calls not GCC but the high-tech compiler, and TESI needs to know where this compiler is installed, and TESI also links the test application, and TESI needs to know which startup code to use, which memory layout to use, which linker file to use, and so on. And if we do now the same now with a changed environment, TESI does not longer use a GCC compiler but uses a high-tech compiler and creates a binary for Oryx. And this binary then is executed in the UDE, in the debugger, acting as an instruction set simulator for Oryx. And you see here that you get other measures such in the console view than we have during execution with GCC. TESI connects now to UDE and loads the application, runs the tests, and we have now the same results for the two test cases as with the execution on with GCC. If we switch to the test data editor, so we have the same results. And now we want to find out how easy it is to create a test report. It's just by clicking on this button here. TESI can create test reports in different formats. I can have, for instance, HTML as I selected here. And you see here also the settings for the Oryx compiler, and you see the linker file and the configurations, the options, and so on. But the important thing that I wanted to show you is the results of the two test cases. The first test case passes, which is indicated by this green tick mark here on the right hand side. The second test case failed. We see the input values 5, 2, and 7. The actual value is yes, and we expected no, it was not equal, and therefore the test case failed. TESI can create also test reports in Word format, in PDF format, and in XML format. So that's about test reports. I close now this and back to TESI. Our task is now to find out why the second test case did not give the expected result. And the jumping point is that I can here check this define breakpoint at test object, and if I execute now the second test case with this option set, the tests will not run to its end, but we will stop in the debugger, and we are able to do line steps in the debugger to find out why this test case did not give the expected result. And please have a look at the console view. Now TESI is communicating with UDE and says we have reached a user-defined breakpoint, and we can switch to UDE. And we see here that we stand now at the beginning of our test object with a breakpoint, and we can do line steps here. For instance, we can step in, and we see that we are now in our test object, and we can also mark variables and see the value of v1, and it is 7. It means we are now in the second test case, because only the second test case has the value 7 for v1. We can do other line steps, and my expectation is that the return no in the then branch of the second if instruction would be executed. This would give me my expected result, but if I do another line step, I see that the return yes is executed and not the return no, and the culprit is a missing equal sign in the decision of the second if instruction. And as soon as you know about that, you can run the test to its end. I click on this here, and now the tests are run to its end. And if I go back to TESI, I see that the test object, the test case still is wrong because it's failed because it does not work as expected. I can now go and use a built-in editor in Tessie to correct the programming defect by inserting an equal sign here. And if I save it and if I go back to the test data editor, I can execute now the test cases with a change test object. I can use this button here with execute both test cases at the same time. But please note that there's a difference here. For the second test case, we do a confirmation test, which means we try to verify that the correction we did, the bug fix we did, actually works. And for the first test case, we do a regression testing because we want to verify that the bug fix we did not cause now the first test case to fail. And both tests are now green, which means the confirmation test was positive, so the bug fix actually works, and it does not make the first test case fail, which also good. So we could say we are finished with testing, with testing. But especially if you do safety critical projects, you need to measure the code coverage that you have reached with the test cases. And I would like to do this now also with Tessie. It's quite easy to find this out. I need just to execute the two test cases or all the test cases that I have with instrumentation. And I have preselected that I want to measure branch coverage and modified condition decision coverage. And during the execution of the test cases, I want to show you the measures that used in safety critical standards for code coverage. Here on the left-hand side, you see entry point coverage, statement coverage, branch coverage, and modified condition decision coverage. And on the right-hand side, you see the safety critical standards, which mentions these measures. Entry point coverage is only mentioned by 615.08, so general safety critical standard. And the other three coverage measures are mentioned by all the other safety critical standard. 26262 is for automotive and 5128 is for railway application. So these are the standards that are the measures that are mentioned in these standards, and Tessie is able to measure all four coverage measures. But in our example, I have only selected branch coverage and modified condition decision coverage. Okay, back to Tessie. Yeah, Tessie in the meantime has executed the two test cases and measured which coverage they reach. And this is depicted here. We have here a column called C1, which stands for branch coverage. And we see that the two test cases have only reached 75% coverage. And the same is with MCDC coverage, also only 75%. And if we want to know more about the coverage and what about the details of coverage, we switch to the coverage viewer perspective. You see here in the middle of this perspective a flowchart of our test object with green and red branches. Green means, of course, executed, and red means not executed. And we have also a display, a source code display of our test object with lines shaded in green and lines shaded in red, which also means executed, not executed. And if we click, for instance, on this red branch here, we see that it corresponds to the return no in line 27, or to the then branch of the second of the first if instruction. And yeah, so we can see the relation between the flowchart and the source code. The flowchart tells us yes, accumulated results of two test cases, but I can also select maybe only one test case, a second test case, and now the flowchart shows me the path of the second test case through the test object. And if I click on this green branch here, I see that this green branch corresponds to the return no in line 30, or in other words, to the then part of the second if instruction. And if you remember, we introduced the equal sign in the decision of the second if instruction, especially to have the second test case to execute the return no in line 30. So it's everything is consistent here. We can also mark select the red diamond symbol. This shows us that the decision in the first if instruction always evaluated to false in both test cases, or at least we can also mark both test cases here. So note we need another test case where this decision evaluates to true to reach 100% coverage, but we don't do this during this demonstration. I think it's clear what test case we should need. Maybe a test case where the value of V1 is 4 or 3 or something like that, smaller than 5. This is the end of the practical demonstration, which means we have to do a concluding step here about the main additional features of TESI. I would like to present them to you, and they are in a separate presentation. It's a very quick presentation, just a rough overview. First of all, there's a certificate from the TÜV Süd in Munich in Germany, which states that TESI can be used for the development or testing of safety critical applications. The certificate covers 6508, the general standard for safety critical projects, 26262 for automotive, 5128 for railway application, and 62304 for medical applications. And in case the certificate should not be sufficient to cover the topic of tool qualification in the standards that you are using, there's a separate tool qualification package available which you can use to qualify TESI on your own for your embedded project if this should become necessary. If you have a look at the V model, we see that TESI cannot only be used for module or unit testing, as we have seen here in this practical demonstration. TESI can also be used for integration testing, so another process step in the V model. And the test object of integration testing in TESI is called a component. A component consists of several units which interact in some way. Also, data is contained in this component. And these tests, these integration tests or component tests, are technically quite different to the unit testing that we have seen. So that's a complete different technique for testing the interaction of units. TESI also contains a requirement management system. This means you can create requirements in TESI, link them to test cases, and then you get evaluations if all requirements have a test case linked to it, if this test case has passed or failed, and so on. You can also use your own requirement management system and import the test cases in TESI. TESI can import test cases in the requirements interchange format, and most requirements management systems are able to export this. TESI can even export test cases in requirements interchange format file, so you can reread it in your requirements management system. But you can also have quite simpler requirement management formats, like a plain ASCII file which just gives the name and a priority and something like that. I said TESI contains a perspective which allows you to create test case specification according to the classification tree method. We see such a method, a specification here. It consists mainly of two parts. The classification tree here is the top part, and the table below specifies test cases. And this classification tree method includes also equivalence partitioning. You see here on the left hand side, for instance, for steering angle, the values are divided in three equivalent classes called left, central, and right. And you see on the right hand side that there are also invalid values and extreme values and so on. So it's quite easy to specify with the classification tree method test cases according to, let's say, 26.26.2, where equivalence classes and boundary values are recommended for test case specification. TESI can also display test data graphically. We see here in the middle a display of 20 test cases. The input value is the beige step curve, and obviously the task of the test object was to smoothen this step curve, and the expected values are in blue and the actual values are in green, and you see that most of the time actual and expected is the same. Just for three test cases has a slight difference, and this is easier to spot and analyze if you have it in a graphical presentation than as you have to look in Excel sheets or something like that. TESI automatically creates from the test cases that were input by using GUI or input by using an Excel sheet or something like that, textual representation. This is created automatically, and the main purpose is that you can save this textual representation to a file and put it under version control and compare it with the test cases you save at a later point in time and compare it, and you see the progress of the testing. And of course you can also write or import test cases in this textual form, and so you are able to restore test cases from a former point in time. That's the main purpose of the textual representation or the script editor. The main purpose is not that you write test cases in this format. I think this would be too much effort. TESI features the command language, so you can operate TESI over the command language, so even without user interface, also in headless mode. And this command language is the base, forms the base for the integration of continuous integration systems with TESI in such systems. For instance, TESI can be integrated in Jenkins, that's quite often done, and the command language here is a base for that. TESI is a dynamic testing tool, but a little bit of static analysis features are present. TESI can calculate metrics, for instance, a cyclomatic complexity or nesting depth or something like that. You can specify two thresholds, usually a warning threshold and an error threshold, and the values of the metrics is displayed in shaded in red. If the error threshold is exceeded, and it's shaded in yellow, if the warning threshold is exceeded, and if it's green, it's all okay. TESI has also a nice feature which is called mutation testing. TESI can automatically do mutation testing. It starts after testing has finished, so it is a situation where you have all test cases in a past state, and mutation testing is that TESI mutates automatically your test object, which means it introduces small errors. For instance, it replaces a logical AND by a logical OR, and then all the tests are rerun, and the expectation is that at least one of the tests fails, and therefore detects that the original test object changed, and so this rates the quality of your test cases. Okay, I'm now at the end of the video. If you want to have more information about TESI, you have here this web address, www.hitex.com/TESI. This allows you also access to an evaluation version. Evaluation is free of charge. It's for 10 days, and you have a full functional version of TESI. You can even use cross compilers and everything. And yeah, so please make use of this. I invite you for that. And yeah, as I said, I come to the end of this video. I hope it was useful for you. And if you have some questions that come to mind later, you see here my email address. Please feel free to write me an email, and I would be happy to answer. So thank you very much, and goodbye.